You're listening to Just Hit Play with your hosts, Peter and Nick Cabral. If you're tired of your stagnant, streamed music feed, then strap yourselves in for an intergenerational sonic journey through Peter and Nick's favorite songs.
Welcome to episode 52 of Just Hit Play. I'm your host, Peter. With me is my co-host, Nick. Nick, how you doing?
I'm doing really well. I've had a great weekend so far. Liverpool won a trophy. Celtics just won a big game 7. Unfortunate about the Bruins yesterday, but
yeah,
shit happens.
It does.
And I saw a fantastic concert last night in Buffalo, so everything's been going well.
I was gonna ask you about the concert, but before we get into your concert, it's been a year, 52 weeks. This is a year.
Oh yeah, it has. Damn.
So
that's something.
I didn't want to. I'm a little rushed at work because I'm working pretty much 5-6 days a week at the moment. So I want to sort of get into your favorite song that we've played so far, but I don't want to do that just yet. I think we'll do that in a couple of weeks when we have a little bit more time. So we'll do a special episode. Maybe I'll get your top 5 of the songs that we listen to in a couple of weeks. But yeah, it's been a year. It's been a lot of fun for me. I've really enjoyed it. It's like I've gotten to know you so much better. Obviously, I missed your childhood when you were growing up. I was there sporadically. So it's been really good for me. And, I've always wanted to do a podcast like this, so it's been fun.
Yeah, I completely agree. I echo the same sentiment. I've had a blast doing this. It's something I look forward to every week, getting on with you and chatting about music and life. And yeah, I'm very excited to see where this goes. And I think this next year is going to end up being even better. So
yeah,
onward we go.
Onward we go. So yeah, so in a couple of weeks, we'll do our favorite songs that we've listened to so far this year. And I want to hear about your show. So you went to Buffalo. When I saw a show in Buffalo, I was like, wow, Buffalo really is depressing. It kind of sucks as a city. What was your, like, this was 15 years ago that I would have done it. So how did you find Buffalo?
I got to be honest, I had the exact opposite experience in Buffalo this weekend.
Yeah.
I stayed outside of the city. I just got a motel near the airport. But when I was downtown last night for the show, just walking around, the vibes felt good. There were a lot of bars and clubs that were pretty active and it looked like everyone was having a really good time. There was this big theater putting on a musical and like the whole area the concert was in was super busy and everything just seemed great. And the people of Buffalo were fantastic. I met a lot of really cool people, had some nice conversations in line, waiting for the show. Yeah, I got to tip my hat to Buffalo. Maybe they've turned it around since you've been, but that was great.
When I was there,
the show itself was, but yes, tell me about your experience.
When I was there, I went to go see U2 and the city was dead. Like Buffalo was always one of those cities, and it sounds like it's changed where people work in the city and they live outside of the city. The great thing about Toronto is that no matter what time of day or night you're up, there's always people milling around. It's a very vibrant city, and I just did not get that feeling from Buffalo at all. So it's good to see that they've actually put some money back into revitalizing the city.
Yeah, I definitely got that sense. And then the Justin Bieber concert was also last night, so I'm sure that helped.
It was
vibrant.
Was he playing there as well?
Yeah, he was playing at the their arena.
It was a Freddie Gibbs, Justin Bieber crowd mix at some point.
Exactly.
Tell me about the show.
Well, the venue, first of all, was fantastic. Everything in there was great. There were two openers for the show, Redvale and Mike. I hadn't heard of either of them, but they were both phenomenal. Like really, really, really impressive. The first opener, Redvale, he's an 18-year-old rapper from Maryland.
Right.
And his set was so good, the crowd was cheering for him to keep doing more songs. And how often do you see that with an opener?
You don't see that very often, no.
And then Mike, he was also phenomenal, another rapper. His production was so jazzy and soulful, really lyrical rapper, so that was great. And then Freddie Gibbs was absolutely amazing, better than I even hoped for. And I've been to a lot of hip-hop concerts, but I have to say that this one last night was the best display of rapping I've ever seen live. Like just the action of rapping he put on a masterclass. It was fantastic.
And how many, was it a big venue? Like how many people were at this show?
Not very big at all. Maybe 2,000 at most. Mm. So pretty small, but I prefer that. And I was second row, so I had a great view the whole time.
Right. Now, was it general admission or was it seats?
It was general admission, yeah. Okay,
cool.
Yeah, and what Freddie Gibbs did, which I thought was really cool, is he'd start every song just by going right into one of the verses a cappella, just out of nowhere.
Oh, okay.
And then he'd be like, all right, run that back and play the track with the instrumental and go through the whole song. And then the last verse, he would cut the instrumental and go fully a cappella again. And it was That's so cool. Yeah. Just when I saw Thundercat, I had the feeling of, wow, I'm seeing an incredible musician, someone who's just so skilled at their playing their instrument. And I had the same feeling with Freddie Gibbs. I thought, wow, I'm seeing an incredible rapper right now. Someone who can rap like not many other people can.
Cool. Yeah, things are starting to open up here again. The concerts are happening. So I'm going to see a couple shows in August. I have friends and bands. Obviously, we've played a lot of the independent artists are friends of mine that play in bands. So they're playing shows. So it's nice to see that the world is opening up again. Did you have to wear a mask? Like, what was your requirements going across the border?
Yeah, no mask to go across the border. To go into the U.S., I don't think I had to be vaccinated. Like, I showed that I was. They asked. And then no masking requirements at the show. And then on the way back, coming back into Canada, if I wasn't fully vaccinated, I would have had to show proof of a negative test. But I just showed that I've been vaccinated and they let me through no problem.
Do you know something I found out recently is that a lot of the sports teams that have to play in Toronto don't fly into Toronto. They land in Buffalo and they bus it from Buffalo to Toronto, because if you fly in, you have to show a negative test if you come in from the States. But if you bus in, or if you do a land transfer, you don't have to show a negative test. You just have to show your vaccination status. So
that makes sense.
When the Blue Jays are playing a road trip and they're coming back to Toronto, they actually land in Buffalo and they drive to Toronto. And when they're playing, when they have to go on a road trip, they actually drive to Buffalo and fly out of Buffalo. They don't land in Toronto, Tampa Bay, when Tampa Bay was playing the Leafs, they did the same thing. Like all the hockey teams would land in Buffalo and then drive across the border.
Speaking of Tampa Bay and the Leafs, we should offer our condolences to all
to the Leaf
Leafs
Nation
fans listening. Yeah, it's a Leaf Nation. That's a tough one.
I don't know what it is about the Leafs, but they just cannot win a game 7 to save their lives. Like when they're facing elimination, they're eliminated. It's something else.
To be fair, Tampa Bay is a very strong opponent, and from I wasn't watching the game. Obviously, I was at the concert, but from everything I read online. Especially from Leafs fans, are saying that the team played well. It's just Tampa played better, and it's tough. I mean, I guess that's easier to swallow than last year when we know what happened last year with the Canadiens beating them. But
they lost to essentially a farm team, like an American Hockey League team equivalent. I know they made the finals, but you know teams can get hot. But you know they're like one of the worst teams I've ever seen. The Canadiens. Yeah. And, you know, what really bothered me last year, I know this is a music podcast, and we'll get into the music. Everyone was so excited last year because the Leafs had such a good team, but they were just playing against Canadian teams.
Yeah.
Like they were playing the Canadiens and the Winnipeg Jets 20 times
and
a season.
They're in the Suns.
Yeah. And Ottawa, like how good were they? Like there's no indication of how good they were because they were playing six, seven teams, basically.
Yeah, and you look at the Canucks, the Sens, and Canadiens, three teams that are all actively rebuilding.
Right.
The Jets, they're in a weird transition phase where they're on the brink of needing a rebuild.
Yep.
And it's basically just the Oilers and Flames that were like competitive teams. So that is a good point.
Yeah, so I don't know why everyone was so excited last season because there was no indication that this team was going to do anything. They didn't. So, good luck to them. Hope they get out of their funk at some point, I guess.
I like doing this thing where I go on the Maple Leafs subreddit, their community on Reddit, and just see what they have to say. And I saw a lot of people saying that they've taken a vow to only start paying attention to the Leafs after they've made the second round of the playoffs.
That's good.
And I feel like that might be good advice for some Leafs fans out there. Just try ignoring them until they actually get into the second round, and then you don't have to be let down.
Obviously, I don't know if your dad still does hockey pools like every year. Is he still doing that?
That sort of fell by the wayside with COVID. We haven't done that in a couple of years.
So obviously I was there in the year one before you were born back in the 90s. And I love doing hockey pools with Leaf fans because they always had to have a Leaf on their hockey pool teams. And the Leafs have, you know, there was never a 60 goal scorer, 64 goal scorer in the history. They'd always take these like run of the mill 10 goal scorers, you know, 12 assist players. So yeah, I always love doing hockey pool with Leaf fans. They're the best.
Speaking of hockey pool, Leafs fans, all that, I ran into our cousin Mario yesterday. Yeah. He's a big fan of the podcast, actually.
Yes, he is.
He's letting me know. Yes. And he wanted me to say that he wants to hear us talk about Trooper, Raise a Little Hell, Boys in the Bright White Sports Car. So,
yeah, so Mario, we'll, I guess we'll play some Trooper for Canada Day. God, I never thought I'd play Trooper, but there we go. We'll do just some for you. We'll do some of my favorite Canadian bands for Canada Day. How's that?
Or Motley Crue. He also name dropped Motley Crue, Def Leppard. Pick your poison. Although he said he doesn't like poison.
Nor should anyone like poison. That's yeah, Mario, I'm glad you're listening to the podcast. We need to really expand your musical tastes. So that's good. Now, I actually had my friend Julie send me a message. She was listening to our episode about the Drake, what's his name, beef?
Pusha T
beef. And she was able to impress her son with the amount of information she knew now about Drake and Pusha T. So she totally freaked out her son after listening to our podcast. And so we're helping out the people with their interactions with their children.
That makes me so happy to hear. Yeah. I'm so glad you're able to do that, Julie. That makes me proud and puts a smile on my face.
Yeah. So, her son got really freaked out and he's like, "Mom, what the fuck?" And, so this is our new service. We're going to do this podcast. If you want to connect with your children, listen to our podcast, or if you're children and you want to connect to your parents and find out what the 80s and 90s were like, you should listen to this podcast.
There you go. It's perfect.
Yeah. So I thought that was quite funny when she was telling me that she freaked out her son.
No, that is really funny. And like I said, puts a smile on my face.
Yes. No, it was good. I laughed when she said that. All right, let's get into some music.
Yes.
We're going to listen to New Order, Blue Monday. Now, I know you know this song, but I want to play this. I want to freak you out a little bit. Okay. Just hit play on Blue Monday. I love that song so much. It's so iconic. You know, the synths, the drum beat, which is electronic drums, by the way. That's not a drummer. Now, do you know why I got you to listen to this song?
Because you thought I'd like it. Rightfully so. I do love this song.
Yeah, it's an amazing. It's such an amazing song. It's one of those classic 80s songs. It's so specifically 80s. Yeah. Okay. Now, the reason I got you to listen to this song is because New Order is a revamped band. And we've actually listened to the original New Order on this podcast.
Oh, yeah. Aren't they from Joy Division?
Can you imagine that New Order and Joy Division are kind of the same band?
Yeah, when I first read that, blew my mind. Like, that's crazy.
Yeah.
But you know what? It, like, after really listening to this song for this episode, I'm not as surprised as I once was, because I'm not sure if it's a choir sample or if it was recorded for the track, but those vocals that play for almost the whole thing, it makes it despite how danceable the track is, and that comes from the synths, the electronic drums, those vocals give it such a moody atmosphere, and that felt very Joy Division-esque.
Yes. There is a darkness to this song. Well, it's called Blue Monday, so I'm assuming they don't like Mondays. Now, when Ian Curtis died, so Ian Curtis of Joy Division committed suicide before the day before they were going to go on their big first American tour, the band decided to continue, but they wanted to change up their sound completely. So they had agreed, all the members of Joy Division agreed that if any band member left, they would discontinue the band and change their sound. And that's where you get New Order. So it's a completely different sound to what Joy Division, which was really minimalist, really dark, just drums and guitar and bass, where this is, you know, there's synths, there's drum machines. It's very danceable. Joy Division's definitely not a dance band.
Oh, no way.
No. So, yeah, they decided to change their sound completely. Yeah.
So my favorite New Order song is Bizarre Love Triangle, which is is an even poppier, more dancey track than this. So it's pretty crazy to think about where Joy Division, what they turned into. The fact that they turned into this band, I can see some of these New Order songs charting really well, selling really well, being played in clubs. And Love Will Tear Us Apart by Joy Division, that's not a song you'd ever hear in a club. there's no way.
No, and I'm glad you brought up clubs, because there's a famous club that New Order were part of. It was called La Hacienda in Manchester. They were part owners with Tony Wilson, who was the guy who created Factory Records, which is what New Order are on.
Okay.
Now, Tony Wilson was an interesting character. He recently died. Even though he had all these bands signed to Factory Records, let me rephrase that. All these bands released albums on Factory Records, but none of them were signed to Factory Records. They could come and go as they pleased. To everyone's chagrin, when another record label came in to buy out Factory Records, and they could basically made no money, because when the record label found out, they was like, so we can just sign these bands without buying Factory Records? And they're like, yeah. And they're like, okay, well, we're just going to sign all these bands and not pay a cent to Factory Records. That was his shtick. That was his philosophy. Is like he wanted to help bands, but he didn't want to own bands. So Factory Records did not sign specifically anyone to any contract obligations.
I love that. That makes me respect Tony Wilson a lot, because as we both know, the music industry is incredibly exploitative, and they lock artists and bands into ridiculous contracts with crazy obligations and percentages that don't even make sense. It's pretty disgusting, honestly, what a lot of record labels do to musicians. So I have a lot of respect for this Tony Wilson character.
Well, there's a movie called 24-Hour Party People, which I think I've mentioned on this podcast before.
I think on the Sex
Pistols. It is an amazing, amazing movie. So if you ever get a chance to see 24-Hour Party People, especially for music history, you sort of have to watch it. Now, there was a specific Manchester scene that was coming out this time, and Tony Wilson dubbed it Madchester. This is where rave culture started, was in Manchester.
Oh, very interesting.
So you had the La Hacienda, which was the club, which is where the sort of the underground dance movement rave scene sort of started, was with this scene. And especially the bands that were playing that La Hacienda and the drugs that were being taken at La Hacienda, which was mostly MDMA.
And that makes sense that Manchester was the sort of where that scene originated. There's a lot of abandoned warehouses and empty warehouses in Manchester for people to go dance and take drugs
especially
at.
Especially in the 90s where, you know, Manchester is a port city, obviously. And there was a really bad recession happening in England in the 80s and 90s. So a lot of English cities were really, really poor, and they suffered badly during this recession. And what increases during a recession or a depression? Alcohol use and drug use.
Yep, like clockwork.
So those are the things that increase. And Some of the bands that are playing the Hacienda are just some iconic bands. We had the Stone Roses, who I love, the Happy Mondays, and Spiral Carpets, Charlatans, James, 808 State. These were some of the bands that played that La Hacienda. Now, in Spiral Carpets are an interesting band. A, what a stupid name for a band.
I think it's kind of nice.
You kind of like the Spiral Carpets?
I kind of like it.
If I'm not mistaken, Noel Gallagher was the roadie for In Spiral Carpets.
Oh, okay.
And he later became, obviously, the lead guitar player and singer-songwriter. Well, songwriter for Oasis. He was never the lead singer for Oasis. Yeah, so again, Liam and Noel Gallagher being from Manchester as well.
Yeah, I'm not a big Oasis fan, so that doesn't really do much for me.
Doesn't do much for you? One of the things that there's a lot of bouncers that worked at La Hacienda, and one of their favorite stories to tell is how many Manchester United players and City players they would kick out of the club for being too intoxicated. Apparently Ryan Giggs was thrown out of La Hacienda a lot in the early 90s, and some City players that I have no idea who they are because City's a small club. So
yeah,
I have no idea who they were. But yeah.
No history there.
There's no history at City at all.
Yeah,
so that was always a fun thing. How many Manchester United, let's just stick to Manchester United because City don't really matter.
No.
How many Manchester United players were kicked out of the club back in the day? Yeah.
I'm surprised Fergie allowed that, but whatever.
Well, Fergie would have spies all over the city to tell him what their players got up to.
Oh.
So he pretty much knew what every player got up to. He was like an octopus. He had his tentacles in a lot of pies, we'll say. Yeah.
Okay, including the rave scene.
Yes, including the rave scene. People would report back to him, and ordinary citizens would report back to him to go, yeah, I saw David Beckham here and all this kind of stuff. And they didn't really understand how he knew exactly what was going on, but yeah, he always sort of knew. Yeah.
That's hilarious. I like that.
Yeah. 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 So, drugs were very important to the early, rave culture. Obviously raves, you go to do drugs. So, have you ever been to a rave?
No, never.
No.
It's not really what it used
it's
to be.
It's not a thing anymore, is it?
No. There's EDM festivals, which carry on the spirit of raves. People wear the glow sticks and the body paint, and they have the huge bracelets up the arms. And there's a lot of drug use. I've never been to one. That's not really my type of music. But it's not really like the old warehouses and empty fields that it used to be. It's now sort of been more commercialized. It's major festivals and stuff now.
A lot of my friends were into the rave scene when I was growing up, because obviously I was in the heyday of the rave scene.
Yep.
I've been to one rave, and because I don't really do any chemicals, like I smoked pot back in the day, but I never really took MDMA or any acid or speed or anything like that. The line to the bar was always empty because no one was really drinking. So, you know, to get a beer was always pretty simple.
That worked out for you then.
What I always thought was funny is I never understood why a lot of the rave kids wore soothers, you know, those baby soothers sort of thing.
Yeah. Do you know the
and
reason?
I found that. Yeah. They grind their teeth.
Yeah.
Yeah. MDMA makes you grind your teeth. So I was like, oh yeah, that's crazy. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing. I don't really feel like walking around with a soother for however long an MDMA trip takes. So that kind of turns me off, along with the dehydration and all that bad stuff.
Yeah.
No.
You know, Portugal is quite an interesting country. They legalized or decriminalized every drug.
Yes, actually.
So no drugs are actually illegal in Portugal. They treat it more like a health issue and not a police issue.
Yeah,
which I think is fascinating.
I took a political science elective in my second year of university, and for one of my final projects in that class, we just had to write a paper on basically any political topic. And at the time, I was getting really into public health and just subjects like that. And I wrote a paper on Portugal's drug decriminalization, and yeah, it's been very successful for them in a lot of different categories.
Yeah. Absolutely. Which surprises the hell out of me. Growing up Portuguese and the parents that I had, I'm much more used to a very conservative style of of relationships with the Portuguese people that I know. So when I heard Portugal did this, I was like, wow, that's a big step for this culture. Yeah.
Well, our family is also from the Azores, so maybe it's a bit of a different culture.
It is, yeah.
Versus the mainland as well. But yeah, in a lot of areas, Portugal is very progressive just in terms of the laws they have in place.
Yeah, so I was really happy to see that and how well it's turned out. So, I know Canada decriminalized pot a few years ago. I would love to see it go further and every drug be decriminalized. But unfortunately, with the right-wing propaganda that's happening in Canada at the moment, that'll be quite difficult.
Yeah, well, knowing that this is still a music podcast, not a drug podcast, I will just say that Canada's on the way to decriminalizing magic mushrooms and MDMA, actually, for therapeutic reasons. Yeah. They're doing a lot of research and studies into
so much research.
Yeah. Mushrooms have been found to be really, really effective for treating addiction and alcoholism.
Yep.
MDMA or Molly has had really, really promising results with treating PTSD. So it's certainly heading in the direction that those will be decriminalized for medical purposes. So that's kind of cool. I always like when alternative medicines that actually have science behind them and things like that are gaining ground. So yeah, cool to see.
Yeah, unfortunately, back in the 80s, when Just Say No sort of movement came under the Reagan era and then what Bill Clinton did. So Bill Clinton was the three strikes are out sort of rule, where if you committed three crimes, you could spend the rest of your life in jail. It decimated the black community, especially. A lot of people see Bill Clinton as a friend to the black community, and I don't think so. What he did to America with that three strikes you're out sort of thing, and he really doubled down on drug sentencing. It was not a good thing.
Yeah. Well. Portugal is sort of leading the way across the world and getting things like that reversed and people being able to see the benefits and having drugs decriminalized just for freeing up police resources and allowing people to get help for their addictions, as well as seeing research and studies and results for how they can be used therapeutically. So, and in addition to that, I'm sure Portugal also has a very good rave scene still. Given the fact that people
won't
be locked up for it.
Yeah, I bet. Like, that's amazing. I've been getting the travel bug, and I've been watching a lot of travel things on YouTube about people that go to Lisbon and Porto and the Algarve. So I'm starting to get that itch. I want to do some traveling soon. So hopefully I've never stepped foot on the mainland in Portugal, so I'd love to actually go to Lisbon and spend some time hanging around.
One of my good friends, Thomas, just did a week in Lisbon with his friends, his roommates. They went to Lisbon and he said he had an amazing time. He loved his week in Lisbon. Apparently it's a really, really good city for young people to visit on travel. It's got just a very youth friendly culture. And it's really geared towards young tourists now, which is cool.
Yeah. No, I think we're going to try to do a big trip next year, whether we do Europe or we have this idea of landing in LA, driving to Vancouver, driving over the Rockies to Calgary, and then driving back to LA from Calgary.
Wow.
Either that or we want to do a Europe tour. So we're not exactly sure what we're going to do next year. So both are in the cards because I turn 50 next year. So I would like to do a big trip for my 50th. So we'll see what happens.
That only seems right.
Yeah. So I don't have any kids. So let's travel the world while I still have the ability to do that and all my marbles on me. Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. No, getting back to the music. So I adore New Order. I think they're a fantastic band, and especially from where they came from. What a great song Blue Monday is.
I couldn't agree more. As I've said, if I'm being honest, the only two New Order songs I know and are in my library are Blue Monday and Bizarre Love Triangle. But love this song very, very much. I can see it feels ahead of its time to me. I can definitely see how a band like LCD Sound System, which has been on this podcast, could see how they would be inspired by New Order.
Yeah.
Just in terms of the song length and how some aspects of the song are very consistent. They never change. You've got like that core synth line, the choir vocals, but then you've got dynamic things in other areas. that's all pretty cool. It feels like it may have been experimental when it came out, but now it sounds great.
Well, Joy Division inspired countless bands. New Order inspired countless bands. So big, really important in music history is New Order and Joy Division. I don't think they get their, you know, I don't know if New Order or Joy Division are in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Joy Division might be, but I think they deserve much more praise than they've ever received because they're just fantastic.
Yeah. Well, they're getting that praise from us. So hopefully that counts for something.
Love New Order.
Yeah.
Okay, let's get into some Julian Baker. Now, when you sent me the link for Julian Baker, I thought it was going to be a dude. So tell me about Julian Baker.
Yeah, so Julian Baker, she grew up in suburban Memphis, Tennessee. She makes really, really good indie music. It's driven by her fantastic guitar and piano playing abilities, as well as I think she's a lovely singer. A lot of her music is really sad and melancholic, and that's something I love about her. But I'll get your thoughts after Darren just hits play. So, yeah, obviously I love this song. That's why I'm showing it to you. So before I really get into this, what were your initial thoughts or the things that stick out to you from this one?
Yeah, so obviously this would fall under the category of like a bedroom pop sort of genre that we've talked about in other episodes.
I think an argument could be made for that. She does do a lot of the work herself, but I think she's at the point in her career. This was on her third album, I believe, second or third, so she's got resources and a studio time and all that. But in terms of the DIY aspect and how she's a multi-instrumentalist, it can definitely be bedroom pop adjacent.
I love the song. I think it's just definitely a song you want to listen to on your headphones when you're walking around or you know, if you're going for a drive. It has that really slow build to it. The only thing I didn't like, and I love music videos, I thought with a song like this and how intimate it is and you know, of how emotional it is, that you could release a very dynamic music video, but there wasn't one. It was just words on a screen, which is an unfortunate thing. I think she missed a trick there. I think she could have really have done something amazing with this song.
I agree. I could see a really artsy music video getting put out for this one by some indie film director. You could easily see that
exactly
happening.
No, I think that's my only thing. I think she really could have made something dynamic in this with this song.
I agree, but musically I think there's so much to love in this track.
It's a great song. It's a great song.
The reverb heavy guitar in the background is great. I love the bass, and like you said, it fits in the late night drive category, and that's my personal favorite type of music. If it gets added to my late night playlist, it's one of my favorite songs. So this has all, since I've heard it, it's been one of my favorites. It really struck me on the first listen of the album. This is the song that stood out to me. And go ahead.
Yeah, I think another thing that I really like is how simple it is. If you look at the New Order song, which is not a simple song, there's a lot of overdubs and overlays and drum machines and synth parts. This is a very simple song, and I kind of love simple music. I grew up with punk rock and all that kind of stuff, so I really just love simple music to my core.
Well, you used a word that I think is perfect for this song earlier. You said it's intimate, and I think that's an excellent description for not just this song, but Julian Baker's discography as a whole. It's, as I said earlier, it's really melancholic and low-key music she makes. And what took it a level deeper for me in terms of appreciating her work was when I learned a little bit about her backstory. So her music is mostly informed by her experiences being a lesbian woman and a Christian at the same time. And,
that would be interesting. Yeah.
She said that one of the most pivotal moments or experiences of her life was growing up. She had queer friends, and obviously growing up in Memphis, Tennessee, that's a very conservative Christian environment. And she would see a lot of her friends with different sexual orientations be labeled as outcasts and not accepted by their family and other friends when they came out. But when she finally had the courage to come out to her family as being a lesbian, she was, in her words, radically accepted. And that's something that became a really powerful moment for her. And that sense of conflict within her is really what drives her music and creative output. She has a relationship with religion and trying to navigate those beliefs with her own identity. And I think that really, when you look at it from that lens, her music, her lyrics, it takes a level deeper.
Right. Yeah. I didn't know that must be tough being a Christian and a gay person, because not all Christians are accepting of homosexuality. So that's gotta be, especially if she comes from a Christian household, that's gotta be a tough thing to go through.
Yeah. I can only imagine the feeling of turmoil or just opposing beliefs and ideals and feelings within yourself. And it sounds like to me, from what I've read, that she turned a lot of that into, in my opinion, great music. And I think that's really cool. And I also think that that's a perspective that isn't really explored much or heard much in music. That sense of being a queer person, but also having strong ties to religion. It's not seen very often, and it's pretty cool and unique, I think.
Especially with what's happening in the southern states right now, with a lot of stuff that's happening in Florida. There's a lot of anti-gay sort of measures, especially coming from governments. So it's really important that we have artists like this I hate to use this term, but speak their truth. I think that's such a
it's a bit of a cliche. It's been
so widely used that it makes me cringe a little bit. But you know, to me, if she's writing true to life music, then she's a soul artist, and we definitely need more of that in today's world.
I like that soul artist is speaking about your life experiences. That's a cool way to think of it.
Yeah. Soul. I don't think like punk rock, I don't think soul music has a specific music that has to be associated with it. I think it is, if you're talking about yourself and some things you're going through, to me, that's a soul song.
Yeah, absolutely. And she certainly talks about herself and her experiences in a lot of her music.
Yeah.
And what, in addition to her identity and religion, what I find sets Julian Baker apart is I find her lyrics be pretty abstract. And I've listened to this song over 100 times for sure. And even still, I don't really have a strong grasp on exactly what the message of the song is or the story she's trying to tell. It's more about emotion and feeling rather than, I think, anything more concrete or defined than that. And that's also something I think is cool, where every listen you can connect to it in a slightly different way based on which lyrics speak to you the most, how you interpret them based on what you're feeling. That's something I think is really special about music.
Great. You know, and when I was listening to the song, it sort of dawned on me as well that I think the songs that I'm getting you to listen to, it's very underrepresented. There's an underrepresentation of females in the music that I'm getting you to listen to from my end. So I'm going to stick to the 80s for next month still. And we're going to listen to just female singers or songwriters from the 80s, because there are some amazing, amazing songs that from the 80s that were released by women. So we're going to continue the 80s for one more month. So bear with me. And we're going to listen to some, Kate Bush, especially Kate Bush, because I love Kate Bush. So we're going to listen to some really amazing songs in the 80s.
Cool. Yeah, I'm very excited for that. Definitely. Yeah. I don't have the context of growing up in that time or living in that time, but just from what I can infer, I would think that the music industry wasn't as kind to females. I'm not saying it really is now, but I'm sure it was much harder then for women to really break through as artists and hit the mainstream back then. Mm.
Well, I think it's still, to some extent, it still happens today. There's an Australian band called The Preachers that I really love. And the front person of The Preachers is a woman. And I'm reading an interview with her, and she goes on tour, and she'll go to like a concert venue, and the promoter or the people that are putting on the show will talk to her band. We'll look at her band members who are all male and tell them what's going to happen. And they never address her specifically, even though she's like the lead singer and, you know, and started the band and things like that. They always talk to the men in the band, thinking that they will know what they're talking about, things like that.
Yeah. That sadly, that doesn't really surprise me at all. No. Yeah, it's not great, but
So I'm glad you brought her to our attention, Julian Baker. And I really love the song. I think it's beautifully written, it's beautifully performed. I really dug it.
Yeah, and just before we end off talking about Julian Baker, do you remember Phoebe Bridgers? We did her song Kyoto,
sure,
one of the very first episodes. Yeah.
Love Phoebe Bridgers. Yeah.
Julian Baker and Phoebe Bridgers are really, really close friends. And they have actually a group together along with another artist named Lucy Dacus. They have a group, the three of them, called Boy Genius. I think they've released one album together. So they also make great, really, really great music together, the three of them.
Cool. Yeah, I could see that. I could see their similarities in the music. So I could see why they would, team up. That makes perfect sense.
Yeah, really, really good. So if anyone listening has enjoyed this song, or if they enjoy Phoebe Bridgers, I definitely recommend checking out their group together, Boy Genius. It's fantastic music.
Cool. Definitely. Yeah, that's awesome. Nick, do you have a song for me next week?
I do. Yeah. So it's called Skybox by Gunna.
Yep.
Yeah, there's a very specific reason I picked this song.
Cool.
And we'll see what comes out of it.
Right, cool. I'm going to get you to listen to some Smiths. I don't know if you ever heard of the Smiths.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I've heard of them. I know of their reputation and stature, but I've never checked them out for myself. So I'm excited.
So we're going to listen to How Soon Is Now by the Smiths. One thing you should know about the Smiths is they release very interesting song titles. Like How Soon Is Now, Please, Please, Please Let Me Get What I Want This Time, Girlfriend in a Coma, It's Serious, I Know. So they release very very interesting song titles. So we're going to listen to the Smiths and going to delve into Morrissey, the lead singer of the Smiths.
Yes, and I am familiar with Morrissey just from his recent controversies and things he said in the media and online recently.
Yeah, so we'll dig into the Smiths. Cool. Looking forward to next week. All right. Let's get into This Week in Music History. This Week in Music History. All right, I am happily reporting that Tie a Yellow Ribbon Around the Old Oak Tree is not number one this week.
Thank God.
Thank God. I can't say that about the year 2000, but we'll get into that in a second. So the number one song in this week in 1973 is Stevie Wonder, You Are the Sunshine of My Life. I love this song. Even though it's a number one Stevie Wonder song, I don't think it's one of his best known songs, but it is absolutely beautiful and sweet, and I love the song. So Darren, just hit play on Stevie Wonder.
I feel like this is the beginning.
Cool. And as I said, the year 2000 is still Maria Maria by Santana. You know, back in the year 2000, if you told me the song would still be ravaging my life 22 years later, I would be very upset. And it is, unfortunately. 22 years later, and it's still my nemesis. Oh, boy. All right. So
when will this torment end?
Yeah. We're going to listen to the number 7 song this week by Creed, called Higher. I hate Creed so much. This is such a bad song. And this song has 63 million views on YouTube.
Oh my God. Those are Drake numbers.
Let me say this. If you're listening to this podcast and you go, what's this guy talking about? Creed are amazing. please seek help. You know, there are people out there to help you, and maybe get rid of your mullet. You know, that
we just lost all three Creed fans. All three of them.
Oh, they are the worst band. It's God, they're terrible. All right, let's hear a little bit of Higher by Creed. Darren, hit it. Wow, what a terrible song. Just
bad.
It's bad.
Just bad.
It's bad. Yeah. And I watched the video for it, and I hadn't seen this video in a long time, and Scott Stapp, the lead singer of Creed, is doing his Jesus Christ poses, and you know, his arms are wide open. I think they have a song called "Arms Wide Open" as well, which is equally terrible. So, yeah, he just has one of those really punchable faces. I just want to punch him in the face.
Yeah, to me, it seems like he really enjoys almost cosplaying as Jesus Christ.
Right.
Like he really sees himself inheriting that persona. It's kind of weird.
It's they're terrible, terrible band. All right. So before we finish the episode, every week we highlight an independent artist. So if you like any of the independent artists that we play, please listen to them on your streaming services, whether it's Apple, Amazon, or Spotify, or YouTube, however you listen to music. It's really important that we support independent artists. And this week's independent artist is Isabel Wood. So with her song, Run and Hide, I think it's a really lovely song. And this is a little bit of a bio on Isabel Wood. Wearing her heart on her sleeve and doing it in style, Isabel Wood skillfully combines her sugary sweet vocals with sticky melodies and vulnerable lyrics to create sonically compelling emotional pop. And I agree. This song is really cool. And so we're going to listen to Run and Hide by Isabel Wood. Nick, I will talk to you next week.
You got it. Looking forward to it.
All right. See you.
Expectations never die, they never die.
You've been listening to Just Hit Play. To contact your hosts, Peter and Nick, or to be featured on an episode as musical talent, email justhitplay7300@gmail.com. Keep up to date with news and announcements by following on Instagram and Facebook, linked in the show notes. Subscribe on your favorite podcatcher to tune in next week for more Sonic Delights.